to see you.
All right.
Okay, we're going to call to order the regular city council meeting of May 9th, 2022. Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Here.
Salvia?
Here.
Albrecht?
Here.
Gould?
Here.
Harrison?
Here.
Peterson?
Here.
Sage?
Here.
Thank you. Will you please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everybody, for coming on this beautiful night. I think spring is sprung, as they say. So welcome, everybody. First, we have public comments, scheduled and non-scheduled presentations. First, we'll have an update from our Oakland County Commissioner, Adam Kochendorfer. Adam, come on up. You're first.
Much Mayor Bixson, Mayor Pro Tem Salvia, members of City Council, thank you very much for having me. It's been a little while since we've seen each other in person. I missed you guys. I just wanted to give a very brief update of what's going on in Oakland County these days. Before I do, though, I wanted to address a situation that's a somber, obviously. I think one of the last times that I talked with this group, we had that student from Stony Creek High School who had tragically been struck on Tinkin when she was trying to cross. A lot of people have been working on this issue, trying to prevent that from happening again. And Oakland County Road Commission and Rochester School District have been working on this, have started installing pedestrian-activated crosswalks around the community that you may have already seen. We're not done with that yet. We're still looking to see what technologies are out there to improve the crosswalks that we have. But I think that a big improvement has been made, and hopefully there's more to come so we don't ever see this happen again. On to a more lighter note, one of the bigger things that we're dealing with these days is last year Oakland County received sort of the first round of funding under the American Rescue Plan Act. And that was $122 million, believe it or not, and then more on the way. And so we've been looking carefully. We have probably at least 90% of that is still with the county. Thinking about looking at closely, what do we do with these funds that is going to be in the best interest, the long-term interest of the county? And we've already done some things that I think I wholly support. One of the examples is actually an idea that my opponent had in the last election. I thought she raised a great point, was happy to work with her on something. It's mental health. Especially since COVID, this is a huge issue for first responders, for our teachers, all throughout the community. Devoted $8.5 million to grants that were awarded to 42 nonprofits across the county, all based on merit, to be able to invest in this critical area. I was very, very happy to see that. One of the other things that was included in our recent budget was local road funding. It's always a favorite.
Yay.
Put away $4 million. Rochester is always very diligent every year about applying for that. I highly encourage you to do that again this year. I will do whatever I can to get that grant passed. Please, you've got my cell phone, you've got my email address, contact me so we can make sure that that gets in on time. And then, of course, there are groups across the Board of Commissioners who are looking at other ways, other investments for that money. Some very good ideas, some not so much, but hey, blue sky thinking. And we're continuing to work through that issue. One of the other things that we recently did was park grants. When the county voted in an additional millage for Oakland County Parks just a few years ago, part of that was funding for local communities. And Rochester, again, smartly applied for some of that funding. We're able to give you some of that funding for bridge repair, I believe, in Paint Creek. Yep. I was glad that we could put that to good use. So please, please keep it coming. On the advocacy front, one of the things I've been working on is Highland Park. Mayor Pro Tem Salvia wrote to me, thank you very much for that. You've likely heard in the papers that Highland Park has not been paying their water bills for some time. There is a dispute between them and GLEWA. It's been ongoing. But in the meantime, there's been an effort to pass those costs along to other Oakland County taxpayers. I strongly disagree with that. So I and a number of other commissioners have introduced a resolution urging that those costs should not be passed on to taxpayers. Highland Park needs to either pay its fair share or the state of Michigan needs to step in. They were part of the genesis of this problem, frankly. But nevertheless, those costs should not be passed on to the city of Rochester. Again, we continue to work through all these different issues. There's a lot happening. And in the meantime, you may have heard that the district maps have changed for this year. And so you'll be seeing me again before November. You haven't gotten rid of me just yet. But you may have heard I am not running again. It has been an honor to serve this community for a long time now. I'll hold off on all the goodbyes for some time, and even then it will not be goodbye. But it's been a pleasure serving you, and happy to take any questions that you may have.
Councilmember Albrecht.
Adam, thanks for coming as always, and thanks for the update. Two things on that crosswalk where that was my neighbor, and that crosswalk does have the flashing lights there that they put in. I've probably been there for 2 to 3 months now, so that's a step in the right direction. And then secondly, in terms of the advocacy you were talking about, in the water fund, are we? I know last time we talked, Macomb County had decided to put their contributions into escrow. Is Oakland County doing that until this gets resolved?
I've talked to the water commissioner, Commissioner Nash, on this issue, and the last I heard, and I encourage you to write to him directly. I'm not going to speak for him, but in his reply email to me, it was his position that we should continue pushing the state of Michigan to pay for this. But he was also hesitant to have other Oakland County communities stop paying. He was concerned about investment. I understand that loud and clear. But my sense is that if we take a stand, it's more likely to speed up and expedite a resolution. So we have a slight disagreement on that. So at the time, there's no plans of the county to escrow that money. But we have not voted on the resolution that's been introduced. That's going through the committee process right now, and we'll see how that vote turns out.
Thank you.
Councilmember Peterson.
Hi, good evening, and thank you for being here. So regarding the water, so this is the second time Highland Park has done this to us. So, will the state just not stop that from happening then?
Yeah, it's been going on for many, many years now, actually. Mm-hmm. It's been continuous. I want to say they paid like something like 1% of what's been billed
right.
to them. And it's in litigation, right? It's a genuine pending dispute. I get that, but Rochester taxpayers shouldn't bear the cost of that dispute. And litigation, at the end of the day, should solve the problem. But in the meantime, I just don't want it to come down on our back. So eventually, this will be resolved one way or another.
Awesome. Next question is, what is going to happen to the law library out in Oakland County?
Yeah, it's a great question. I will ask, I've not heard a recent update, but I will ask and get you an answer for what the status of that is. I know they made room for an additional courtroom years ago, and a lot of space was lost. But let me find out and get back to you.
Okay. I heard that with technology, they want to put it all on electronic.
There's been discussions about that for at least 3 years, but I'm not aware if a final decision has been made.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Banda?
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Dickinson, our street superintendent, wanted you to know that we did apply for the grant already, so we're in line, and we thank you for your support. So
I
appreciate that.
There you go. You guys are already on top of it. There you go.
Anything further? Thank you, Mr. Kochendorfer, and we will see you soon.
Thanks for your support.
Thank you. Next, speaking of the state, we have Michigan State Representative Mark Tisdale. Mr. Tisdale, welcome.
He has to end with a big word like superfluous. And then, you know. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, and council members for having me back in. It's nice to be here when it's still light out and no snow on the ground. That's for sure. We're in the process right now at the state level of passing all of our appropriations bills. The coming fiscal year bottom line is going to be huge. I think it's the number is something like 75 or 76 billion, so it's several billion over prior year. If you back out all the one-time federal spending, it's really a 1.4% increase. So in light of the recent inflation that we've incurred, that's pretty darn good, and I think we've got that spending under control. But there's an awful lot of federal dollars that have to go, you know, basically be used or we lose them. Just brought some notes along here. Out of the billions of federal dollars that we have available to spend, in this next coming year, we're setting aside $1 billion for anticipated tax relief. The legislature passed a bill to temporarily suspend the gas tax. That was vetoed. The legislature passed a bill to lower the 4.25 income tax to 3.9. In addition, it would have increased income exemption from tax for seniors, lower that age from 67 down to 62, and would have doubled it from $20,000 to $40,000 for an individual on retirement income, and up to $80,000 for a couple. That was vetoed. $4 billion will go to debt reduction. The Michigan Public School employees, pension funds, state police pension funds, university professors, pension funds, those that are still receiving a pension. Ultimately, these dollars, these funds are the responsibility of not all public school teachers will get the pension. I think probably all.
So Mr. Coker never talked about mental health for teachers?
But ultimately, these pension funds and for cities, we're helping address the poor performing cities get back up to speed. And then there are requirements and clawbacks in there for them to get that money. Ultimately, these pensions could end up being the state's responsibility anyway. So when we have this opportunity to invest a significant amount of money in those, you know, if we can't address it now, I don't know when we can. We talk about better roads and bridges and grants coming down to locals. It's going to be $6.8 billion in the road fund this year. $750 million of that will bypass MDOT and come straight to the counties and locals. That will still be distributed on an Act 51 formula, but it just skips right through MDOT and comes down to the locals. A lot of this again is federal money. We recognize that all those federal dollars are essentially new debt that we will be servicing for decades to come. My objective, and many on my side of the aisle, has been to put that money into goods that will have a long shelf life and be around for decades as well. With the leak of the Supreme Court opinion, which very well may have simply been an exercise inside the Supreme Court, which is not unusual, but in light of that, we've also put aside another $21 million for prenatal and postnatal care for those that are in need. See what else we've got along here. $20 billion will be the new state school aid fund. $9,000 per student, that's up $300 from last year. That's up $2,000 from a decade ago. So it's really been significant growth, and there's been $500 million set aside to recruit and retain teachers. And I mean, it just, it goes on and on and on. Everything is going to be up. An additional $48 million increase for the state universities, and it's and there's going to be some adjustments. The legislative budget includes a 46% increase for Oakland University. They've been part of the strive for $4,500 per student state funding. They're currently getting, I want to say it's $3,069. So it'll be nearly a 50% increase on that, which should get them to the 45. Oakland, Grand Valley, maybe Saginaw Valley have been kind of the lowest funded for a long, long time. In comparison, the University of Michigan, obviously a great school, they get $11,000 per student. So 369 to 11,000. There's some room for improvement there, and we've been working on that. Again, another $155 million going into the Michigan Reconnect program, and we're trying to move the age of that from 25 to 21, so those young adults that have not yet reached or earned an associate's degree or a certification in a marketable, skilled labor program, extra money for that, and again, trying to move that age down to 25. The only other thing I would point to is that last Tuesday, I had a bill that I've been working on for a year that's of my own creation. It's not out of a lobbying firm or special interest group, but it would be a requirement that biological fathers, unwed fathers, automatically have a 50% obligation towards the mother's Medicaid allocation toward prenatal and birth expenses, and 50% of the Medicaid allocation for the child's ongoing protection. This has been federal policy and state policy for almost half a century. The 1975 Social Security Act, Title IV, Section D, mandated states to develop an Office of Child Support. We got that in Michigan underway in 1982, and the objective is to transfer responsibility from the state back to those people that are legally responsible for such support. About 45% of all births in Michigan are paid for by Medicaid. From 2000, yes, indeed, WOW is the response. Wow. So from 2008 to 2022, we have averaged about 49,000 Medicaid births per year. So that's about 633,000 Medicaid births in that period of time, that 13 years. In 2002, the Medicaid budget in Michigan was $6 billion. This year, it will be $22 billion. That's one-third of the entire budget. We can't sustain growth at that levels. So, and for those that might think this is targeting one racial group or ethnic group over there, almost 69% of all Medicaid births go to white mothers. So this is not a racial issue. It's a budget issue. Mm-hmm. And the state has a direct interest in that. So working on that one right now, and it can be a little touchy in some sectors. Last but not least, the Senate and the House may shortly be looking at, I'm going to ask your opinion on something, the State and the House will shortly be looking at a term limits and financial disclosure bill. Mm-hmm. There's a petition going around Michigan to put this on the ballot. I sponsored and voted for the House bill that would require the executive branch to fill out financial disclosure, the governor and all of the lieutenant governor and all the executives she appoints. I also voted for the companion legislation that would require that of all legislators. There's a concern relative to me and my district from a political standpoint that should I vote for the legislature's version of this, it could open the door for me to serve 5 more terms or 10 more years if that passes. One of the concerns is that I'll be looked at simply as another career politician wanting to feed at the trough. Let me assure everyone here, if reelected this fall, I will be 67 years old. I have no interest in serving anywhere, doing anything to age 77. So be assured that I will not be pursuing
Susan
the new available 5 terms if there. And certainly, again, I sponsored the financial disclosure bill for the executive branch and voted for the legislative financial disclosure bill. So I anticipate I'll be voting for the state and state Senate and House versions of term limits and financial disclosure as well. Open for questions.
I'll take one.
Mayor Pro Tem Salvia.
Thank you. Thank you, Representative Tisdale. Thanks for being here. What I heard there was there's lots of dollars, and Rochester has a very active grant committee led by Treasurer Maggio, and we have a lot of hard asset projects that we will continue to keep knocking on your door.
The bridge right back there.
Yep.
For one, yes.
Yep. Thank you.
There you go. Thank you. Councilmember Peterson.
Yes, thank you, and thank you for being here. So regarding the term limit bill.
Yes.
Wouldn't that allow you, though, if you chose to stay until you were 77, actually do part in the Senate and the other part in the House?
Well, the primary difference is today you can serve 3 2-year terms in the House and 2 4-year terms in the Senate. Combined, that totals 14 years. One of the concerns is that as people get into the House, they start looking at that next step when Senate seats become available. And it's that jockeying back and forth. What the new term limits bills and petition drive would do is reduce that to 12 years total. Mm-hmm. So you could be 12 years total in the House, which would be 6 terms, 12 years or 12 years total in the Senate, or any combination thereof. But one member of our caucus, a freshman, was sworn in January and announced in May that he was running for the Senate. You know, I know of at least 2 others that are in that situation. And you know, I came here and said I was going to be your voice in the House, and that's going to be my job. I like the job very much. It's a great job. The Capitol building's a great place to work, and the support that we get from partisan and nonpartisan staff and researchers and assets is significant. So this is my plan, but that would be the biggest change. 12 in the House, 12 in the Senate, or some combination versus a total of 14, and maybe it would get people to at least minimize their looking to jump around.
Awesome, thank you.
Further questions? Thank you. I always like to hear about money for roads, money for teachers, and money for the University of Michigan. So thank you for coming.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
Right, Sam, thank what you heard.
That's what I heard. I don't know.
I'm not getting any there to get too
but
much.
Didn't he say there was none for you, though, Mayor?
Yes.
I forgot that part. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything further, Brian? Is there any?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm not seeing any public comment at
okay.
this time.
Thank you. Next, we have approval of the minutes. It's a consideration of the minutes of the regular meeting of April 25th, 2022. And Madam Clerk, everybody got the addendum of the verbatim.
Yes, Your Honor.
So if there's a motion, we will include that in the minutes if somebody wants to do that.
Thank you.
So is there a motion? Councilmember Peterson.
Yes, thank you. So no, I did not get that in my email
okay.
just because I had not been in my email
okay.
to get that from you.
Okay.
But I did email earlier just about one change in okay. the minutes because I believe on 10A, I don't recall it being $435,000.
That four is probably supposed to be a dollar sign.
Yeah, that's what I thought, so.
Okay, I'll change that.
Okay, so then there's, is there a motion for the current minutes without the addendum?
So moved.
Motion by Councilmember Peterson. Is there support?
Support.
Support by Councilmember Albrecht. Discussion. Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Yes.
Salvia?
Yes.
Albrecht?
Yes.
Gould?
Yes.
Harrison?
Yes.
Peterson?
Yes.
Sage?
Yes.
Thank you, and we will consider the verbatim at the next meeting.
Yes, Your Honor, it will be an agenda item.
Thank you. Next is approval of the consent agenda. First is consideration of special event application from the Rochester PSD to hold the Thursday night markets on West 3rd on 5 Thursdays in June, starting on June 2nd, which isn't that far away. Consideration of a special event application from the Kiwanis Club of Rochester to hold music in the park on June 16th, 23rd, 30th, July 2nd, 14th, 21st, 28th. And the event will be in our band shell. And then C is review of the current event calendar.
Motion to approve.
Motion by Councilmember Albrecht.
Support.
Support by Councilmember Peterson. Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Yes.
Salvia?
Yes.
Albrecht?
Yes.
Gould?
Yes.
Harrison?
Yes.
Peterson?
Yes.
Sage?
Yes.
Mayor?
Councilmember Albrecht.
On 6B, just the Kiwanis do such a great job of these summer concerts. I mean, if you've ever been there, just people bring their chairs and their, you know, dinners and everything else to watch it. And they have a whole, you know, some are rock and roll, some are country, some are classical. So, and it looks like they've added some dates because it looks like there's 7 dates. And I think in the past it's been 5 or 6. So a shout out to the Kiwanis for bringing this back. And I will be there at a few of them.
Very good. Thank you. Next, there's no old business or table items. There are no public hearing, legislative deliberation. We are at the stage of the resolution adopting the fiscal year 2023 budget. Mr. Banda.
Mr. Maggio and his team, obviously along with City Council, have been amazing in this process. When I think as smooth as it could have gone. I think by building this 3-year budget, we seem to get this baseline taken care of out of the chute, which will let us focus more on the future things and that next dollar. As you heard our speakers tonight talk about, we're going to have opportunities for grants, et cetera. So we have to be well prepared for that. Staff's up for that challenge. And Anthony can give you a quick overview of what you heard at his great presentation a couple of weeks ago.
Mr. Treasurer, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Council. We did have the presentation, and I'm sad to say tonight I am still not in Disney. So that was great, so thank you for allowing the Zooming in. Family had a great time, and technology is great. So presentation was at the last meeting. I did want to just highlight a couple things, just as a summary. We have a balanced budget. Just under $30,000 to the positive, so we are navigating and getting through COVID well, and we're going to continue to stay strong. You have attached the resolution, which is standard, and new this year, and that's what I wanted to call a little bit of attention to this form here. This normally you don't see this usually. And Councilmember Salvia pointed that out in some questions, and I thought it was worth just having a quick discussion on what this is and why it's important. And this document right here is what the state of Michigan requires you as a treasurer to sign and clerk to certify that the rates are true, you've met the requirements, and you are certifying under lots of penalties that everything is true and accurate and presented fairly. And here we have the city services. So we have the general charter millage here. So back in September of 67, date of election, originally authorized at 20. This next column here is the 2020. So this is the rate as permanently reduced by Headley. So this was last year's maximum amount. This column here is the calculation for Headley for this last year. So you can think of this as kind of like a percent. So it went down, it's basically you can levy 99.58% of what you did the prior year. So coming up in 22, this number here in these two in the columns here are 99.58% of what was last year's. And then this gives the maximum amount that can be levied by the municipality and OPCs, also with grouped into city services as well. So we have our maximum amount. The truth in taxation, we follow all of the state requirements in the truth in taxation, including having a public hearing, getting input, making sure there's certain requirements in the document itself the state requires for you to make the truth in taxation and assessing requirements. And if you don't do those things, you get reduced not just by Headley, but there's like a second rollback on top of it. If you don't have a public hearing, for instance, automatic reduction on top of Headley. So it just further constrains down the line. We always follow all of the requirements, and we're very open and transparent with the process, the budget, the numbers. So we have not had to have any additional rollbacks because of that. You end up in the last one, which is then the maximum amount allowed, and then what's actually being levied. So OPCs just following down 3150. The city still 12.5364, which is still below the 13.7044, which would be the maximum that's authorized. And in the last paragraph in the section here, we have the breakdown. I'll zoom in a little bit. And so we have the 11.5964, which is general operating. And then we have the 0.94 for infrastructure. So that was the amount designated by council to say, hey, we want that money to be specifically going to infrastructure. And then that gives the city the total right here. And then grand total, including OPC, the 12.8514. So I just wanted to take a second to kind of talk about that, and just so that the public knows and council knows where we're at. It's not the maximum allowable under law following the reductions with Headley. 13.7044 would be the maximum amount. We're not at that. We're still at the 12.5364 that was levied last year, continues no increases in it, the same for this year. And then we have the OPC as well. So any questions or any other comments? Happy to answer that.
Councilmember Albrecht.
So sticking on this page that you're on, where you had the 13.7623 reduced by column 6 to get to the 13.7044. So when we're sitting here next year looking at this form, the 13.7044 will again be reduced by column 6 by some fraction again to give us a new maximum?
Correct. Yeah, you will see this shifted over. So this next year would then, just as you said, 13.7044. And then whatever the fraction reduction is ends up being for the year will then give the new number.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Treasurer? Okay, do we have a motion to, Councilmember Harrison.
I'd like to make the motion to adopt this year's fiscal budget. I just want to congratulate our administration, the budgeting committee, and the finance department on a job well done, and this council as well. There were a lot of tough questions that were asked and adjustments that were made that I think made this a stronger budget thanks to that input and feedback. And I'd also like to thank the DDA for their flexibility working with us on this budget. I think that there was some compromises made, and I'm really proud of the outcome of that. Just to reiterate, I believe we are continuing to maintain our AAA bond rating for the city, which is really important. We saw an increase in our residential property values by 4.6% and an increase in the state shared revenues. So this is a balanced budget with a modest surplus that we're proposing tonight. And we know that looking ahead, because we have that multi-year budgeting, we potentially are still facing a deficit, but I believe that this is the team and the council that can make those adjustments that we need to continue to be strong fiscally moving forward in the years ahead. So I'd like to support this motion, or make the motion.
Second.
Second by Councilmember Peterson. Further discussion? Mayor Pro Tem Salvia.
Thank you. Thank you. I agree with all of your comments, Councilmember. This has been a good process this year, and happy to see a balanced budget. You know, that means we're allocating those special tax dollars to provide those services that our residents require. I did spend some time going through a lot of the details in the budget, and especially the different goals and objectives for each of the departments, and gave some feedback in an email to administration so that we can see some of those measurable items come through. And I believe Finance Director Maggio is working on some sort of scorecard or report out so we can see on a more regular basis the progress to those metrics. So it's not just once a year where we're taking a look at every department and what's happening, what are the metrics in each department. So I think that'll be great. Made note that there is, during the presentation, you talked about it's a very conservative budget from a planning standpoint in those out years. And so we don't want to, you know, count our chickens before they're hatched, or whatever that expression is. But there is some additional upside from a revenue standpoint as we're looking at interest rates going up. Currently, we have $50,000 a year in interest revenue and that was where interest rates were at zero. We all know interest rates are going up. So again, we don't want to put that in the budget till we receive that income, but that is some upside to the budget. So great work by everybody. And I cannot not comment on the awesome 60-year look back. This for the non-number people makes the budget very interesting, and I think it reflects Rochester's charm and Rochester's character by including this in our budget. Thank you.
Further comments? I would just like to thank Anthony and his team, Marcy, for a job well done. I'd also like to thank the Budget Committee for their work. I know there's been a lot of meetings and a lot of work. I believe this is a conservative, balanced budget. Every year that I've been on City Council, we've had a balanced budget. That's something I'm very proud of. And I think the fiscal and financial strength of Rochester is a key to our city and one of the reasons we are so successful. So I will happily support this budget. So Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Yes.
Salvia?
Yes.
Albrecht?
Yes.
Gould?
Yes.
Harrison?
Yes.
Peterson?
Yes.
Sage?
Yes.
Yes. Also, I just want to thank everybody on the council for their hard work as well. Next on to reports.
Amanda, you got a seven.
Next on to reports and regular business. First is a consideration of a separation agreement with the city manager. Our city manager, Blaine Wing, has resigned. I want to thank Blaine for his years of service to the city, and we wish him well. I believe we have a generous separation agreement that we need to vote on tonight, and that is everyone has that in their packet, and that is what is under consideration for this first item. Mayor Pro Tem Salvia.
Thank you. I'd like to make a motion to approve the separation agreement and release of claims and authorize Mayor Bixson and Clerk O'Connor to sign on behalf of the city.
Support.
Support by Councilmember Peterson. Discussion? Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Yes.
Salvia?
Yes.
Albrecht?
Yes.
Gould?
Yes.
Harrison?
Yes.
Peterson?
With pleasure, yes.
Sage?
Yes.
Thank you. And City Clerk and I will sign that, I believe, tonight. Next, we have a consideration of appointment of an interim city manager. Mayor Pro Tem Salvia?
Sure. I'd like to make a motion to approve Nick Banda as the interim city manager.
Support.
Support by Councilmember Peterson. Discussion? Madam Clerk.
No.
Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Yes.
Salvia?
Yes.
Albrecht?
Yes.
Gould?
Yes.
Harrison?
Yes.
P- Peterson?
Yes.
Sage?
Yes. Congratulations, Mr. Banda.
Thank you.
I would just like to say Mr. Banda has graciously agreed to serve as our interim city manager. Mr. Banda has 40 years of experience in city government. We have a strong group of staff of our department heads and workers. We have a very strong city council. So I believe that we will move this city forward and we will not miss a beat. I have been through a couple of these transitions and a lot of the staff is still here and the staff has stepped up and done a tremendous job. So our goal as a council is to make sure that the city continues to run as efficiently and effectively as we, and we will be starting a search for a new city manager. Next, we have mayoral nominations to various boards and commissions. It's that time of the year, so I have some nominations. First, for Brownfield Development Authority, I would like to appoint Jeffrey Franklin and reappoint Christian Hauser. Next, to the Cemetery Board, we have the ever hardworking Marilyn Trent, William Petrick, and Jack and Beth DeFranco. The Cemetery Committee, for the CBC, we have Jeannie Krupp, Jaden Bay, and Sandra Monte. For the Construction Board of Appeals, Cody Smith. For the DDA, Marilyn Trent and Lisa Germani Williams. The Historical Committee, William Petrick. Parking Advisory Committee, reappoint Jaden Bay. And the Planning Commission, David Gasson and Matt Stone. So those are the appointments. And I know David Gasson, I think, did not get his application in, but he indicated that he was interested in serving again. So those, we will vote on those next meeting. And next we have City Council nominations to
Mr. Mayor.
And commissions.
Just a quick question. On the Historical Commission, did Gail Bothwell not put in her?
She
correct,
did,
I gave you
she
all.
Did not.
Okay.
Is she interested?
I will let you
thank
know.
You.
I thought
so
she had.
Hmm? Yeah, I wasn't sure. And so now on to City Council appointments. Are there any appointments at this meeting? Councilmember Peterson.
Yeah, thank you. First, I had a question regarding the Historical District Commission, because are we still using that? Because we don't really have enough to continue.
Madam Clerk?
This is a board that has never gotten up and running.
Right, I think we talked about disbanding it, but I don't think we ever did.
Right.
Mayor Pro Tem Salvia.
The thought I have on it is I think right now we should continue it as is. And if we can have a few people appointed to it, I think it would be inappropriate and send a wrong message for us to dismember that at this point in time.
Okay. Then we'll try. But are they still going to meet if only have three people?
So again, this board has never had
met.
A quorum
right.
in order to meet at all.
Right.
So you have, it's part of the requirement under the ordinance for the historic districts. So if you were going to disband it, you would need to repeal that whole ordinance. So just so you know the process, but.
So I think it's probably okay to appoint people
okay.
under the guise that probably they won't be meeting anytime
then,
soon.
I'll add Rita Ann Locke. Community network, that was the question I had, though, because that's not in use, and we have people applying for multiple, and I know at one time we would not have people on multiple committees, so.
Right, but we seem to have blown through that tonight, at least.
No, I understand that,
right.
But I don't, you know, right. If a person wants to serve, I'd like to make sure that they're on something that they're actually serving on that is functioning. So so the community media network is for Rita Locke, and this is where it's on almost everything. She is. She's on the next one, too, Pink Creek Trailways. I would like to know how do we really want to handle that?
Yeah, so I will contact her and see which one she's interested in.
Okay, all right. Then I'm not going to make a motion to appoint anyone. There's without that being answered.
Mayor Pro Tem Salvia?
Yeah, so I'd like to nominate James Noss for the Board of Ethics, and that's a renewal. We still have two vacancies on that board.
Mr. Councilmember Sage?
For the Pay Creek Trailway Commission?
Dr. Becker, obviously, we would support that. I would support that, renewing his.
Okay. So we'll bring all those forward next, at the next meeting. Okay, next on to the financial quarterly report. Mr. City Treasurer.
Thank you, Mayor. Pull that back up. So we're running into the third quarter, March 31st report, and there are no requests tonight or action items from it. This is strictly a report. Interim Manager Banda and myself have been talking earlier. We're going to be meeting with and going through the list of all of the outstanding projects across every department and seeing where we're at, what's remaining for the year, what do we need time to roll over, and what are we not going to roll over, because we're going to get that complete by the year end. So you will have those requests for consideration in June. At one of the two meetings in June, we'll pick which one yet, but it'll be one of those two. On the COVID impact, right now, cumulatively, with the first tranche of the $695,000, we are currently through March 31st at a $307,000 total impact to the negative so far. The largest bulk of that is the parking fund. As of the start of the event, $1,119,000 on the impact to that. As we've rolled out, the new meters are all up and running and in place. The decks, we had a little bit of a glitch. Some of you may have seen that, where it was cash only for a couple. We had a few issues. We worked through those. Thank you, Chief, for the assistance on that as we were working on that in Disney as well. So we're making sure we're making sure to try to get that up as quickly as possible back. We now have everything in place that's supposed to be in place. So really, the good measurement's going to start essentially May 1st when we're looking at you know, the meters were in, but then the structures were down, and then we look at all of that. We got through all of that through the end of April. So really now, May 1st going forward, we can see the impacts of what we're looking at. If we're just looking at April, where we still had some issues with the decks, we're still converting over units and getting everything up and running, we're up dollar-wise 4.2%. So what's been put into place is trending in the correct direction. We are no longer at a very steady negative 10%. We're now at the positive for the first time since before COVID. Okay. Obviously, there's a lot of things put into place to make that happen, but the good news is, at least as we look at this out of the gate, it is heading in the direction as was looked.
When you said plus 4.2% for April, so that's plus 4.2% to the positive overall, or plus 4.2% over the minus 10% we're at? So you said two things, so I want to make sure I heard it correctly.
Yeah, so take that as 14% up from the negative 10%.
Okay.
So if we look at pre-COVID on that average time period, if pre-COVID was the baseline, we're 4.2 over the baseline from pre-COVID.
Thank you. Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Which is great, because as you can see, the long-term impacts to the city is really, this was the largest of them, for sure, by far. So getting that corrected is significant. On the total grant funding, so the last of the grants ran out at the end of December 31st. There's still I'm trying to get us about just under $200,000 of remaining potential reimbursements from those programs. So this does not include, this is really the bleeding stop measure from COVID. There's a lot of ARPA programs and things coming down the road for infrastructure, fiber, bridges, water and sewer, those sort of things. That's not what this is going to be capturing or looking at. This was the direct negative impact on the city systems for you know, everything from revenue losses and sewer penalties, Act 51 funding when no one's allowed to drive anywhere. There's no money revenue from gas tax, which we use to fund for the roads. So there's a lot of things that are impacting that. And that's what this is capturing. So now the go forward, there will be less of this directly, as a lot of those are going to be new programs for new things, not as a result of mitigating COVID directly. This chart is now turned into quarters. The orange color is decreases for the quarter overall. Blue is going back up. So you always follow just the tail end of wherever this is at. And so here's following across the $300,000 is where we're at this point in time for Q1 through 22.
Treasurer Maggio, when are we expecting the next ARP funding to
October.
October, okay.
And that will be another $695,000, and there will be some smaller amounts for the residual. In the state of Michigan, any municipalities that either opted out or just said no, they don't want it, that money was then put back into the pie to be distributed out to the other municipalities. So we'll have a little bit more than $695,000, not a lot more than that, but a small amount, and that'll be in October this year, which is part of and in the budget that was adopted.
Okay.
On the, just a couple quick notes, overall larger picture, we're heading right where we should be. There's no big glaring, out of line, unforeseen items that have come thus far or to date. We're finishing the DWSRF program. We're in that final year now. We're doing our annual reporting. This one has no budget, but Nick, for some reason, continues to keep selling benches. So we haven't had a budget in this for years. It's always zero, and yet here we're at, you know, what, $4,720 in bricks and benches and other funds that he's people definitely are interested in those items, which is great. And good placeholders for potential future fundraising ideas. We are low on the revolving equipment. We didn't mark it as such because it's just a timing issue on when we're getting the vehicles. We know what the prices are. They're bid prices. It's not that anything's out of line or unknown from that standpoint. It's just, when can we see delivery dates? You know, the ambulance we're still waiting on from a couple years ago, maybe September. So that's just how it goes. So not horribly out of line by any means. As Council Member Salvia pointed out, investments, right? So on our immediate ones here, on the pools, we're right around 0.75% to 1% is where we're hitting right now as of today. And these sudden larger rate hikes that are going on, you know, the $50,000 a year was right when they were at zero, and it wasn't looking like it was going to change anytime soon. And lo and behold, wham, numbers, inflation, raising rates, let's get things back going again. So to Council Member Salvia's point, that is one that we've put back into the interactive model for future discussion on what is that going to look like, because it's very much not going to be just at $50,000. The SAGE investments, as an example, the money that we have in there, which is going to get more of these funds here as the CDs come due, right now is about 1.81%. as of the end of March, as of this report time. So when we look at some of these, oh, you know, the CDs were great when rates were at zero, we were still able to get 0.6 and 0.7%, roughly maybe a little bit under where the market is right now, but we got that rate for the entire time we've been holding the CD when rates were at zero. So these were Still paying off in the long run, but we will be cycling these out and getting, Sage has been working very well so far with the investments from Sage Advisory Company through Morgan Stanley.
I keep thinking you mean Councilmember Sage.
It is, yeah,
definitely. No relation.
No relation.
I was thinking, wow, he's making the investments now, huh?
It's Sage.
Yeah, definitely not. Not that the Councilmember Sage couldn't do it, but it's definitely no affiliation or anything, no relations there. So overall, we're looking good. I'm going to leave it at that for questions. I just wanted to hit those few high points, and I'll give it back to you, Mayor and Council.
Council questions, comments?
Yep, great job.
Yeah, I'd just like to say that's really good news about the parking. I mean, I think in the parking committee, we were kind of assuming we were going to be down at 10%. And I know Sunday doesn't count, but I was down Sunday for brunch, and there's literally not a place to park. So that's, I think people are back downtown and stuff. So that's that's good news for our parking system.
Very busy Mother's Day downtown.
Mm-hmm. Next, we have an agreement with DiPonio for fiber optics along 4th Street from Oak to Main. Mr. City Manager.
I can give it a go here to start. So this kind of was a surprise, but we're going to run with this. So if you remember when we did our Oak Street project, the goal was to get this fiber optics from City Hall. There you go. Thanks, Anthony. From City Hall, so blue, red, green, all the way to the fire station to get everybody on the same bandwidth, everything, so we can use the highest technology. That picks up our decks also. So Chief Steve's been pushing how can we get all the stuff so we can take advantage of the technology. So in the last go-around when we did Oak from City Hall to 4th, that wasn't in the project cost, but City Council approved a monetary figure so that we could get it there. So that's where it's at right now. So we've worked with the engineers and quickly came up with that it wasn't in the plan again. So a seal caught it. And we worked together quickly to find out how much it would cost to do the red section. That red section would go from Wilcox to Main Street. The big expense comes when you have to bore under Main Street and do pits and all this good stuff. So we're not asking for that now. We know that's the next phase. We'll plan that in our budget planning for next year. And when we do that section of 4th Street. So we're asking for tonight, it's $25,000, I believe, is the not to exceed. That would get the fiber conduit in the ground from Wilcox to 4th Street. We'll stop short of the new concrete on Main Street so that when we have to come back and dig a pit, we can dig it in the asphalt and we won't have to wreck the good concrete that we put down there when we did Main Street makeover. So, Anthony, I'm not sure exactly where we had the dollars set, but out of the infrastructure or out of the IT stuff. So maybe you could just answer that if you would, please.
Oh, sure. Yeah. It's going to be coming out of the construction for the road project. That's where we've done them before. And for anyone that hasn't been around, we started this project really to all the city buildings. So when we redid Ludlow, mm-hmm. we had the conduit run all the mm-hmm. way down to DPW or well, to the bridge, to the end of the road project so that we could get fiber to it. Once the project was done, we then came back, we ran fiber over to the DPW. So that's direct connect to City Hall. The reason it's running down 4th and we were looking at the DWSRF for the future projects is we had the prime opportunity to hit Oak and 4th because those were ones already identified for the project. I'm going to look with our fiber company about getting this started early to the West Deck while we wait for the rest of these to come online. It's about $500 a month for Comcast service to each of these locations. And so once we get this up, the maintenance amounts for the fiber is significantly less. Like for DPW, that run, I think it's $2,400 a year. And that's for maintenance. If there's a line cut, anything happens to it, that includes it getting fixed as well. So there will be some eventual cost savings once we're done with the whole amount. I'm going to look to see if I can get this online sooner than later because I'm not sure when that time's going to happen on the East 4th. And then the Water Street, not necessarily in the picture, that's going to be a bore. We're going to have to just directionally bore it to get to the station. But once that's all done, we can remove and we have solid connections. Every time there's an internet outage for the specifically the two parking platforms, which does happen. Credit cards go down, the communications go down, and people are stuck in the deck, and they got to get out, and those sort of things. So having the fiber connection, there's literally the only thing that can interrupt it, because it's not going out over any other connection, it's that direct line there. So unless somebody severs the line running from that one line from DPW to the city, they're always online, the SCADA system, the monitoring system alarms, it'll be the same thing with these. And it's been a 5-6 year phased projects as we're doing these little sections at a time. But the $25,000 would come out of just the road construction line item, like it did for Oak and for Ludlow.
Yeah, so it's from not Wilcox, it's from Oak to Main. Wilcox, we're not going to go up the road, we don't have to. It's just Oak to the red section there, Oak to Main.
Yeah,
that's sorry, the I said part. Wilcox, yeah.
Councilmember Harrison?
Thank you. Will this affect the business owners on the street as well? Will they now have access to fiber cables for their internet connection?
So this is the large conduit that we're running, and we're hoping to keep an opportunity to have that get to downtown. At the moment, the provider we're using, Merit, is strictly governmental and schools. That's not to say that they won't, but on the east side here, there's a company in internet net 123 net, one of the two, that have been boring and using and getting fiber around town.
Yeah.
They are for businesses and residential if you want a fiber line to your house, but they can do that as well. So when we're running these, our ideas is to get that conduit larger, and we do have some potentially up here from AT&T that was doing the same thing when they ran up here, but these aren't ideal for our locations, to allow them to run that at a significantly cheaper rate, with the idea to get access to downtown with fiber that's below ground and buried instead of up in the air. We really have no room on the above ground pole to pole downtown, that it is everybody has real estate on those poles. There's really not room to run more fiber lines and that on those poles. They're pretty maxed out. So we're kind of trying to create the opportunity to have it there, but.
And is this part of our complete streets initiative? So every time we're redoing a street, we're laying fiber lines?
The conduit on the areas where it's identified that
we need it.
That it's not there yet. So there's a lot where, you know, when AT&T is running their fiber lines throughout town, they're already running conduit and running and boring and doing a lot of these things. So if there's a path or connection, then we want to make sure we're doing this. Because the other thing, too, is like Interim Manager Banda said, you know, you're not digging up unnecessarily, right? A road, you're trying to directionally bore, you got to get the equipment in to push the line, and anytime you can already have those access points, it's one less thing to get re-ripped up again.
And Mr. Brand, if I may, we worked with a group that I think it's the 123 net people on South Street.
Yep.
They ran into this problem with trying to string it.
Yep.
Anywhere, and DTE said it's $60,000 a pole, and you have to replace the pole, we won't do it. So they wanted to get in South Street, but it wasn't deep enough. So they're trying to go along the river, and we're telling them you can't just hang it anywhere you want. Pay for the poles if that's what you want. Upgrade them properly. Because if you look at some of those poles, the weight on those, So we'll be underground, which would be awesome. So.
Yeah.
Mayor Pro Tem Sylvia.
Thank you. I support this, but I did hear someone tonight say there was grant money for fiber. Did you hear that tonight? I can't remember if it was Commissioner Kochendorfer or Tisdale representative. So for this, the green piece, let's try to get some grant money.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I think it was Kochendorfer. Okay. Mm-hmm. Councilmember Gould.
Is the fiber optic, this is for data transfer, I assume, right? Information transfer?
Yes.
I'm just thinking about my house, and it's very nicely wired, and I don't use any of it because it's all via Wi-Fi. Is this for security or dependability or some kind of law, or what is this?
Not law, but it's exactly those first two things. So when we're looking at the reason, for example, the parking platforms, right, all the cameras and that, the gate information running to our credit card servers and everything right now it's encrypted, but it's running out over the net basically to get to City Hall here. That reduces the opportunities because it won't, really the data wouldn't leave that line anymore, right? So you don't have a way to, it's still encrypted at the same levels, but it's way more secure. And we don't have to worry about the bandwidth limitations. The cameras, streaming use a lot, and we actually have had to upgrade and put multiple parts in at the decks because the system's lagging so much, it would chop, it would freeze, the credit card system would get messed up because it's all trying to compete for that same bandwidth. We've had that worked out now for a while, but that's where we can look at it and say, hey, we don't need to pay the high fees for all this extra bandwidth from Comcast in this example, and we can basically run unlimited because there's no throttle on it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Anything further?
No, Mayor, I just had, I understand why we're waiting. I was just wondering if it would have been cheaper to be able to do it all at one time. Since it's going to the fire department and we'd want to make sure they always are online.
Mr. Mayor, so that's a fair question. And so we worked with the engineers and that is a brutal run from under maintenance. When we put in Maine, we thought of this, and we put conduits in there. And if you remember, we also had irrigation under Maine that did all the trees, and all that collapsed the second year. So we can't get through those conduits. And they were undersized for the future. So shame on us 7 years ago. But everybody made their best guess, and the guess was bad. So that's a brutal run to get there. So they want that road open in order to do it efficiently because boring, that's almost impossible. There's so much spaghetti underneath there. So we're going to have to wait until we get the next phase of that. But fair question.
So yeah, another question then. So along, like on East Street, where you're going to would put the other ones, where all the lampposts are, is there conduit, a way to do the conduit under there with that electrical that's already there?
No. So that they just, if you look, that those are literally laid under the grass. So that wasn't very high tech.
No, I've never.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so we were looking for anywhere we could find conduit, but they hadn't thought of that when they did all that.
Okay.
But that's a great point. That's the things we're looking at. When we got the road tore up, that's
complete
the,
streets,
that is
right.
The cheapest time to put this conduit run in.
Okay.
That same run, I mean, you'd be three times more trying to bore it, drill it. And then there's the liability things. They're always cutting through the things you don't know that's there, and especially across Main Street. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if that'd be 50 plus thousand just for them to try to cross Main Street at that point, because that's where you start getting into, there's so much going on that even in the installers, they know if they hit something wrong, they're paying. So it's way, very much more expensive. This, as great as it would be to do it all at once, and maybe we'll look at some of the infrastructure piece because of fire station, to get that funded at once, but it's this is the best, most cost-efficient run without just doing it all at one time.
No, that's right. Fine. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Councilmember Albrecht.
Thank you, Anthony, for and you sort of summarized it with that one line. When you tear up a street, this is the time to do that. You know, it makes sense. And so I'd like to make a motion to approve DePonio Contracting to run the conduit for a total cost not to exceed $25,000 on the map as indicated in red that Finance Director Maggio just shared with us.
Support.
Motion by Councilmember Albrecht, support by Councilmember Peterson. Further discussion? Madam Clerk, the roll, please.
Bixson?
Yes.
Salvia?
Yes.
Albrecht?
Yes.
Gould?
Yes.
Harrison?
Yes.
Peterson?
Yes.
Sage?
Yes. Thank you. Now receive a report from the various boards and commissions. First is a report from the Rochester Area Youth Assistance. Councilmember Harrison.
Thank you, Mayor. We had a very productive meeting. I'd like to thank everyone who attended the pancake breakfast fundraiser held at the firehouse. We're really appreciative of the support that we received there. We had 209 attendees and raised over $1,600. So it was a very successful fundraiser. And some of the money that we're raising is going to marketing initiatives. Right now, we've decided as a board, we're looking for more people that we can help with our funding. So we've actually paid for a Facebook advertisement to boost our services in the community. And this is a very targeted ad. And we also had two like free advertisements, essentially. They were articles in the Community Lifestyles magazine about the grant we received for the mental health boxes and the youth recognition banquet. So there were some nice highlights in the Community Lifestyles magazine that we were grateful for. Another major component that we've been focused on is our continuing family education programs. We had our last one of the season on April 26th at the Rochester Hills Public Library, and we're planning more for the fall season.
Very good, thank you. Next is a report from the Historical Commission, Councilmember Sage.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. A couple quick updates on the historical plaque program. We actually received two applications that were approved for houses that were older than 1901. So that was impressive. We had mentioned earlier too about the success of Founders Day, and we got the final sales tally back. We did sell 10 of the Detroit United Railway books at the event, which was encouraging. And we're all already planning for Founders Day next year. So it'll be earlier than the 17th. It's going to be the 12th of March, and it's going to celebrate the 200th year of the Stony Creek Village. So we're going to piggyback off that, and we'll hold it there at Van Heusen as well.
Very good. Thank you. Next, we receive a report from the Wage and Benefits Committee. Mayor Pro Tem Salvia.
Thank you. Yes, we've met twice as a committee, and I would expect at the next council meeting, the latest, the one after that, we'd have a report out, and then hopefully we can wrap up the work of that committee and disband it. Move on.
Okay. Thank you. Next, we receive a report from the Principal Shopping District, Councilmember Gould.
So, Mr. Mayor, they decided not to meet this month, and so no report from Mr. Gould.
Nope, no report. We decided not to meet this month.
Well done.
I'd heard that. Next year's report from the Planning Commission, Councilmember Sage.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So we entertained a public hearing on the approval of the temporary tent there at the community house. A lot of residents showed up with great input from them, and we approved that motion with the considerable concern to landscaping and concealment of the dumpster right by the community house and the tent. Everything was agreed upon. This temporary approval will last 12 months with continued updates from community house throughout that duration.
Very good. That was a quick meeting. Now on to new business for referral and miscellaneous. Public comment? Any public comment out here? Alec, come on up. We have one of our new city employees coming up to introduce himself, so welcome to our city.
Yeah, hi everyone. I wanted to formally introduce myself. My name is Alec Mizikar. I was hired on as the Economic Development and Public Services Director, so I started last week, so I started my second week here today. Before that, I was the Deputy City Manager and Planning Director for a small farming community over on the west side of the state, city of Coopersville, kind of halfway between Grand Rapids and Grand Haven. So with that, I managed all planning activities and had administrative oversight over their public works and public utilities department. I just want to say I'm excited to be working with the city of Rochester, and I look forward to work with all of you and your manager, Band, and the rest of the staff.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Yes. And it was a very interesting week to start a new job, I would imagine. Brian, anything?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I am not seeing any public comment.
Okay. Madam Clerk?
Nothing this evening, Your Honor.
Sorry. Interim City Manager Banda.
I just want to say you're right. We had an interesting week that we had, and Alec has jumped in with both feet. He's been wonderful. And I'll probably say it every time I see you all, but the support from the staff as a team, off the charts. It's thrilling. All the circumstances. So I just can't thank them enough tomorrow. Now that this is all taken care of tomorrow, I'll start meeting with, we have filling up the council chambers here tomorrow morning with the staff upstairs, whoever's on the fire and police shift in the morning. Christy's been great enough to, we're going to bring them some treats and stuff and just tell them the path forward. This is about the path forward. It's not some rah-rah. We don't need that. We have a great team. We're just going to tell them how much this council supported the way forward, and we're just going to keep working together to get there. And then I meet with that DPW in the afternoon. Then I pick up the other fire and police shifts in the evening. So we want all of them to hear it from our mouths that we're not looking backwards. We're looking forwards, and I think with all the news of the money flying all around, we're going to take advantage of that. So it's fun to see that next dollar. You can start having that thought process, and the next city manager is going to get a great opportunity to do that. So I'm glad to shepherd the ship for until that happens. But, again, without all of these guys, it's as good as it can get, and I thank you for your support.
Thank you, Nick. Nick, did you want to comment on the receipt of the check register reports?
Is there one in there, Anthony, or two of them?
Two.
Yeah, two. There's two of them, right? So, yep. So we'll keep that going so you're well aware of what's going on each month, and we'll get those to you in a timely fashion.
Okay. Thank you, Nick.
I do have a question.
Councilmember Harrison?
Thank you. I have a quick question on the check register report. Just one thing I hadn't seen on it before. April 28th, there's a whole line of these. Is that voided charges, or what is that exactly? On page 87.
Yep. Mr. Maggio?
For April 28th.
Correct, yes. Yeah, the register is, with what we've done with positive pay with the banking, you will now be seeing voids, and that also show up on the check register because our export from this goes to our bank system to stop and void out all the checks automatically through Chase. So, yeah, you will be seeing those now for sure when they come in.
Thank you.
Mr. City Attorney?
Nothing, thank you.
Yeah, I'd just like to make a comment. I would like to thank the city attorney for his counsel during this difficult week for the city. His counsel was much appreciated. Councilmember Gould.
Yeah, thanks. Just a couple of quick comments. Thank you, Nick, for taking the reins. The city is definitely in good hands. I really wanted to thank all of my colleagues for getting us through the budget season. That was interesting. I'm glad there's a budget committee and some folks that know numbers a lot better than I do on that, so effort much appreciated. And what an awesome weekend it was with the weather and it being Mother's Day and everything. It finally felt like downtown was back to normal after really 2 years. It was really, really a treat. Thanks.
Thank you. Mayor Pro Tem Sylvia?
Yes. I'd just like to thank the Rochester Police Department Color Guard for being part of the Rochester Area Prayer Breakfast. The first time the prayer breakfast was back in person over 2 years, so it was great that Rochester was represented there, and a great event. And then secondly, I've been thinking about communication. It's something that we always say we want to communicate more. We want more communication with our residents. How can we do that? And I think one of the tools that we have in place that is underutilized by residents is the civic, the Ready Rochester. And so I started a little campaign on my Facebook page, and I'm just going to challenge my fellow council members as well as administration. Let's see how many new residents we can get to sign up to get those text alerts so that when news happens, I mean, that's how I find out about things in the city half the time is I get a text alert on it. I get reminded about recycling day. So it's a great way to communicate, so let's just get more people engaged on that. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Sage?
Nothing this evening, sir.
Councilmember Albright?
Yes, a few things. One, 3 weeks from today will be the Memorial Day Parade, which is an event that's being put on by the cities of Rochester Hills, Rochester, Oakland Township, and the Veterans Tribute. The parade kicks off at 11:30 at Van Heusen Middle School. We'll march up Adams Road to the Veterans Tribute, where there'll be a ceremony about 30 minutes or so, beginning at 1 o'clock, that we're planning. We invite any groups that want to march or participate in the parade to put in an application through Maggie Bobbitts at the Rochester Regional Chamber. Echoing Council Member Gould's comments, I never miss an opening day for the farmers market, and I'm always there to make sure Christy gives me my bag with all my coupons in it. And so I was there, and I did fill it before I left and ran in, and I know others on City Council stopped, but it was a beautiful day and some exciting new vendors. I want to shame my council member Sage, because he didn't say anything about the Greater Rochester Heritage Days, which will be the Saturday and Sunday before the Memorial Day Parade.
Planning a big surprise for the 23rd.
Okay. you always talk about it like 6 months in a row, so I had to have your back, Steve. So again, do the Rochester Heritage Days in the park, and then again the Memorial Day Parade, where we honor our fallen veterans. And then last but not least, on Arbor Day, April 29th, we did plant 2 trees in the Rochester Municipal Park. The tree committee members, Mayor Pro Tem Salvia, Councilmember Sage, myself were there, along Councilmember Peterson and Harrison also showed up. So we had a nice event. But it's there. And then I'd like to say it was done in partnership with the City Beautiful Commission with Rachel Williams. But last but not least, I just want to thank Nick and the DPW staff, because, you know, we're throwing dirt in the hole and raking, but they do all the work, because if we planted the trees, they probably wouldn't make it more than a couple of weeks. So they were there early. They showed us what to do, and they're going to be 2 beautiful trees with these new emblems that signify or memorialize the fact that we've planted 2 trees on Arbor Day 2022. So more exciting news coming from the tree committee in the next few months. Thanks, Mayor.
Madam Clerk, did you want to give an update on our Memorial Day?
I'm still confirming details, okay. So I'll send out emails to you in the next week or two, but at the next meeting I'll confirm.
Very good. Councilmember Harrison?
Thank you. I'd like to congratulate the DDA for winning a Main Street Oakland County Award. It's the Main Street Safe Award for the Downtown Collaboration Studio. So congratulations on that recognition. Main Street Oakland held the award ceremony last Thursday. Myself and several other council members and board members attended. And it was very well done, a wonderful event, and we were glad to be back in person for the first time in a couple of years. I also wanted to mention that the mural on the gray block building in the municipal park has been completed, so if you have not seen it yet, please head into the municipal park to check it out. It's very well done. We're still going to plan some sort of ribbon cutting or recognition of the completion, but it's up. And congratulations on a successful Arbor Day to our tree committee. The City Beautiful Commission was proud to be a part of that as well.
Very good. Councilmember Peterson.
Yes, and the building is very nice. I saw it the day we did the Arbor Day, so they did a great job. I wanted to actually thank all our employees of the city for being outstanding and working so hard to keep the city together and in the shape that it is in the finance department, especially for really bringing that budget to fruition here and your constant hard work. And thank you, Nick, very much for stepping in. And that's all.
Very good.
One other thing. And Christy, thanks for repaving the farmer's market lot. That was nice to see that.
You did that, Christy?
She did. She did.
Very impressive. Thank you. I'd just like to say a couple quick things. One, thank you, Nick, for stepping up to this job. We appreciate it. I appreciate it personally. I agree with Councilmember Gould. I was down for brunch on Sunday, and town was booming. The restaurants had people standing outside, waiting. So, I think things really are back, which is great. And then I'd like to thank the DPW, the trail and the parks this weekend. Everybody was out, and they look in great shape. So our trail system, our park system, really looks good and is really well maintained. So thank you for that. And without further ado, meeting adjourned. Thank you, everybody.